for opening up the session.
Yeah, I'll be more than happy to be associated with all of you and the institute.
So nice of you, sir. Thank you. Over to you, Manzoor. I think it's 9:29. So like Rohit said, I request all of you to please mute if you are not talking, so that it will not disturb others. Thank you. Dilip sir, can you please mute your mic?
I will do that.
Yes, Manzoor, go ahead.
Good evening all. Me, Professor M.M. Mirza, welcome you for the 55th weekly progress meeting of RA. Today's agenda is actually after this opening remarks, there will be an interview of Mr. Dilip B. Nalode, freelance writer, career coach, upskilling construction. Interviewer will be Professor D.S. Patil, head of programs, construction management, Department of Civil Engineering, RIT. Then there will be the, it will be open for the audience for question and answers. And in the last, there will be concluding remarks. Dear all, we know this RIT Alumni Advisory Hub. It is an independent organization of RIT Alumni, and it is established in year 2020. Our vision is to build a globally active alumni network to run a sustainable and high impact program in a collaborative environment between the alumni, student and RIT Institute. For this, our missions are alumni to alumni, alumni to students and alumni to institution. All the three stakeholders we are covering. These are our missions. Now I will give a brief review of our communities. First is the RA Task Force. RA Task Force is a nodal agency to formulate, monitor and advise on the policies for the running of all the forums. We have different forums, RA Business Network Forum, RA Business Innovation Forum, RA Overseas Community, RA Media Team, RA Cultural Forum, and very important is RA Training and Mentoring Communication Forum. Dear all, actually in the few last two meetings, we had one meeting with the RIT steering committee, all the head of the department, deans and this faculty. And in that we have taken the review of this RA activities and taken some inputs. And then we worked for one week on the preparing the SOPs for all the different communities. Now all these communities will work independently and more focused. I'm going to give some highlights here of the different forums. You can see on the screen different achievements from our forum, RA Business Forum. It is 13 plus business presentations are done, approximately 9 crore business is generated, 20 plus strong referrals are generated, 25 plus employments awarded, 7 plus RIT students are selected as graduate trainee. On the Business Innovation Forum, we are organizing different events as well as we are working on few projects. First important it is e-bicycle project, and in RIT we are working on that. And another it is the wind turbine. We are also working on the slow speed wind turbine. So here you can see we are going to develop this e-bicycle, and you can see one video in which the trial is taken on the bicycle which is developed by us in RIT. So our most active department community is the RA Overseas Community, and all over the world we have the alumni, and they are working here hard for the betterment of the students, to help guide the students for their overseas studies and other mentoring and training, all these things. Rohit, next. So these are some of the initiatives taken from this RA Overseas Community. Next. We have RA Media Team to create the visibility for RA activities, knowledge sharing and technical information of current trends in the industry. Our presence is near about all the social medias. On LinkedIn, we have 1,355 members. On Facebook, we are around 5,000 members. On WhatsApp, we have different groups of different actually age groups as well as for different our communities. And above 1,500 presence is there. We are also on this. We have the YouTube channel. So 122 members are there. You can get all the videos of the this different sessions on YouTube. We are also there on the Twitter. Now I am going to tell you that actually our activity due to the our Rahab Forum, now our alumni have become more active in RIT also. Mr. Sachin Shirsagar from 1995 batch mechanical and Mr. Vaibhav Lokre from the same batch are selected as members for Department Advisory Board of Mechanical Engineering RIT. Mr. Ramesh Jadhav is selected as member of Board of Studies, Department of Mechanical Engineering, and they have conducted one meeting also for DAB and this BOS. Mr. Rajesh Hulugde, Mr. Sachin Shirsagar, and Mr. Yogesh Asimnis are actually guiding the team NECVET for preparation of the project report. Actually, Rajesh conducted 3 meetings and Sachin and Yogesh conducted 1 meeting for preparing their online report of this competition, and definitely I think they will get the first prize. Mr. Abhasaheb Kale is selected as RIT Community Service Project Committee member. So it is actually a part of IUC Leadership Development Program, and already this Abhasaheb Kale is a member of Academic Council Committee for Academic Development of RIT Rajaram Nagar last since 2 years, and he is giving his good inputs in that. Actually 1 week online STTP on application of artificial intelligence in mechanical engineering was organized by mechanical engineering department, and I'm proud to tell you that our alumni Mr. Yogesh Hasabnis was the chief guest for that, and Mr. Amit Patil was the guest of honor. Along with that, they delivered one session or opening session, you can say, for this program. Rohit, next. Now I will hand over to Abha to take forward.
Thank you, Kunju sir. Thank you for very detailed introduction to RAF Forum. It will help our speakers as well as our new joinees from our civil engineering division to know in detail about our various alumni programs. Here comes the first anniversary celebration for entire RA community. We celebrated it on 26th of June. It was a national level knowledge conclave from 9:30 to 10:30, and I'm really happy to share with all. I think it was attended by registrations from more than 12 countries. More than 500 registrations were there. Actual registrations number was very high, but due to some technical reasons, lots of people were not able to join. But still, we could get attendance of more than 500. The most important thing, we had blessings of Sharad Marathiji, who is a special advisor to Prime Minister Office and Task Force Chairman of Ayush Ministry. He is mentoring us. We had chief guest Mr. Satyajit Bhatkar, Mr. Bhagat Singh Patil, and Dr. Mrs. Sushma Kulkarni. All the speeches were outstanding, and specifically Mr. Satyajit Bhatkar, with his background of Pani Foundation, he explained and debated on the subject of social engineering. Today, RA is standing on solid foundation of social engineering, and thanks to Mr. Sharad Marathe to give us vision of agriculture to agri business. We had coupled this entire session with a very state-of-the-art discussion on startups, opportunities for startups in agribusiness. And Mr. Sandeep Shinde, who is the mentor for DISC, which is one of the most innovative incubation center in India and most successful incubation center in India by TCS Foundation. He, along with the entire team, Kalyani, Akshay, Aditya, Gaurav, and Parag. Unfortunately, we missed Parag and Gaurav because of some personal issues, but Aditya took care of all their presentations. We had fantastic debate on opportunities, how you can address problem solving. What we were trying to do is to really propagate the culture of innovation and entrepreneurship at RIT. Our dream is to bring a forum like this to our institute and really do some social engineering projects. Today, we have Mr. Dilip Naloden. It's my great honor and pleasure to introduce him. First of all, I was introduced to him in year 1998 when we were doing a very well-known project of Dabhol LNG terminal and Dabhol power plant, which is very well-known to all of us in Maharashtra because of n number of reasons. Whatever I am today is because of that particular project and my journey with Dilip sir. Now I call him Dilip Kaka because he's being very close relative, which I realize after many years. But to be very frank, one of the best human being at heart, and what makes him today the best industry professional. 36 plus years of experience, out of which he has spent 20 years at Bechtel. One of the, I really admire this organization. He spent a lot of time with Bechtel in Abu Dhabi also. He has experience in infra and oil and gas, as well as construction sector as project management consultant roles. He has worked in various landmark projects like Riyadh Metro, Muscat International, New Doha International Project, which is one of the very big airport project. Shell LNG Terminal in Surat for, I think I was associated with him after Bechtel project. Chemical Terminal in Mumbai and Dabhol Power Project, which I talked about. Aluminium Smelter Project in Behrim. I think these are some of the really huge projects which he has been handling. Now he's in India, he's at Belgaum, and now he's going to join very senior management team at TCE for Bullet Train Project in Gujarat. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation. It all started with his one of the very interesting article on LinkedIn, the current practices in construction industry in India. And he's really opened up eyes of every Indian construction professional that what is going wrong and how we should cope up with global practices. And when I spoke to him, we decided to have one session on that, as well as how civil engineers can have opportunities in our civil industry in India. Once again, thank you, sir, for joining. It is my pleasure to introduce you, Assistant Professor Sri Dhananjay Patil. Dhananjay Patil, sir, has more than 17 years of teaching experience and more than 10 years of industry experiences, which is a really good combination. He is right now pursuing a PhD at Bharati Vidyapeeth. He is M.Tech from COEP Pune and B. Civil from PUPIT Sangli. His research area is building maintenance, watershed management, waste management, project management. And incidentally, he also worked around 98-99 and onwards at Dabhol Power Corporation. So he also is well aware of the practices and the great experience what Bechtel used to give as professionals to all the guys who are working on the project. It's already 9:43. I take a hard stop here and I hand over the entire control to Professor Dhananjay Patil for taking interview of Mr. Dilip Naloden. Over to you, Dhananjay sir. All the best. Thank you. Sir, you are on mute. Dhananjay sir, you are on mute.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Abha sir. And welcome, Dilip, on behalf of Raha committee and Raha team. Once again, I welcome our great guest of honor today, Mr. Dilip Naloden, who has been introduced. And today's interview is basically going to be on the two areas which are very near to the civil engineers' life as such. That is work-life balance. And for the freshers who are joined here today, we'll be talking about how a fresher can get a job in the industry. So, once again, before starting the session, I would like to request all the audience, all the students or the faculty of civil engineering, if you have any questions, I'll request you to put it in the chat, so that if we are not able to cover them all in the meeting, we'll take it at the end of the day. Okay, so now once again I request permission from the Raha team to start this session, and again welcome Mr. Dilip Nallar once again. Shall I start, Abba Sahib and Raha team?
Sir, please go ahead. Sir, please go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Dilip sir, you can unmute yourself.
No. All right. So there I am.
Thank you.
Dilip sir, the first thing I would like to request you to just give a brief about the Indian construction environment.
All right. Okay. So, thanks to Mr. Kale, Mr. Dhananjay, Professor Dhananjay Patil, and Rohit, and there's one more gentleman, Mr. Mirza, for introducing me to this great institute of yours. I was just talking to my mother-in-law also. She mentioned how the founders of the college were visited their house once. So it is all coming back to the, yeah. So it's a big circle. So it's good to know all of you. Okay, first question is about how is the environment in the Indian construction industry? I understand the what is the meaning of environment here is the situation actually on construction sites, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sure. So actually the construction environment is all made up of challenges, hazards, you know, opportunities, goals, milestones, and skill sets. So all these things are part of construction, and it's of course it's very interesting field. Construction is definitely not a boring trade, for that matter. You know, on construction site every day you are building something, and you are bringing the things to the shape, and it's very interesting, and it's always challenging. And you know, when you build things, when you look at the things that you are building and the things that take shape. So construction is a very, very challenging, very interesting and entertaining trade to work on. Is that answer your question, Mr. Patil?
Partially, sir.
Yeah.
I was expecting about the, I'll come to that question. I'll repeat once again the similar type.
Yeah.
I'll go to the second question.
Yes, yes.
See, our students, when we they're placed in the industry, they're not able to cope up appropriately with the industrial environment, maybe.
Possibly. All right. Okay.
Talking about the timings of the work and basically on the infra projects in the remote areas.
Mm-hmm.
So, before going to that particular part, can you just give us a glimpse that what are the basic differences between a real estate projects and an infrastructure project specifically in the remote areas?
Okay, so real estate and infrastructure project, they are all part of huge construction sector. Basically, these are subsectors of the construction sector itself. So infrastructure being the largest of the group, because almost 50% of the construction sector is made up of infrastructure, whereas in real estate is mostly, you know, it's a residential construction, apartments you're building, and associated all utility works in urban areas is a makes up about 25% of in construction sector. So regarding the working culture in remote areas, especially on the infrastructure projects, most of the residential type of projects, I mean real estate projects, are very rarely far off from the towns, you know. So they are very located well within the city limits, maybe outside municipality limits sometimes. But infrastructure projects are really hard, because most of the infrastructure projects, you know, what are infrastructure? These are all roads, bridges, power plants, you know, we built, even the ports. So these are major projects. Sometimes, a lot of times, these are very remote areas, away from cities, maybe 50 kilometers, 100 kilometers from the site. So what happens, you know, the work culture in this kind of areas compared to real estate areas is very, very, is slightly different. I mean, though it is construction process are always similar, but there is some difference, because in remote areas, when you work, you have to live as a, in a group, you have to live in a camps, and that's what makes the difference. And you are living away from the families, your mood may not be, you know, same, because at the end of the day of work, you always want to see family, but that's not really possible when you are working in remote areas. Does that answer your question, Mr. Patel?
Yeah, I'd just like to add a bit to the same thing. I was expecting something like the type of construction was okay with it, but the working hours, those particular things of hurdles in the, and how students can take it up, because correct, the growth path starts from there.
Absolutely. So as far as working hours are concerned, you know, it's either it is real estate or infrastructure, the working hours are in India are same. So officially you are supposed to work 9 hours as per the labor laws, but what I've experienced before I went to Middle East, before I joined multinational companies, they end up working 10 to 12 hours. And that's more than really, you know, 4 hours more than basic hours of work. So it is putting a lot of strain on youngsters, on engineers, and that's what is disturbing the work and life culture in India. Exactly, you're right about that.
So next question: what is the type of pressure that may be on the fresh engineers?
Yeah.
And how can they build themselves,
correct,
to handle that pressure?
All right. See, work pressure. See, as a construction engineer, you are definitely under pressure. And, you know, the pressure, it can be in more than one way. Like always on a construction site, what happens for an engineer is you have to deliver. And you have to deliver the product on time. That's more important. Not only on time, you have to be within the budget.
Yeah.
So you got to be about at least 5-dimensional engineer in order to deliver. First thing is you have to deliver on time, yes, and you have to deliver a quality product, and you have to deliver a safe product. I mean, you have to deliver a work without injuring anyone on site or causing any accidents, any rework on the site. So not only that, it's also deliver the product within the budget. That's more important. So all this cost, time, and safety makes engineer multidimensional. So you have to be always multitasking and look at all these directions. That's a real challenge for a site engineer or a construction engineer on site.
So as a site engineer, how our fresh students can cope up with this?
Yes. See, first thing is always have a orientation. As you pass out from the colleges as a fresh engineer, you want to know what are the exposure conditions on site. You must always understand that when you graduate, you don't know what are the hazards on site. So as soon as you join, you are out of a college, now you want to join a construction project, let us say. First thing you must understand is you must what are the conditions of work? What are your roles and responsibilities? What are the working hours? Okay, so if you understand and try to get orientation and the training, the construction, some construction companies provide training on site, but not all the companies are really, you know, have plans to provide training. So this kind of basic training about construction management, about what kind of skills you require, what kind of responsibilities you own on site, will help site engineers to move forward.
I'll be coming down to the skills and other things in the next part.
Sure.
Talk about that. But before that, now, as a institute or as a teachers,
correct,
what role or what can we do in order, because whatever I've seen, at the time of interviews or when they join as a fresher,
correct,
their self-esteem is down. They're not confident enough to face the whatever, like the challenges or the pressure which is coming. So what an institute, as an institute I'm now talking about, can we do to improve their self-esteem?
It's a good question, because most of the institutes, as I was talking to Mr. Kale some time back, we teach about engineering, we teach about engineering subjects. Technically, we make them sound in theories, in their mental ability and aptitude to do the maths. But what about the practical part of it? I mean, we have to, that's why my request to institutes like you is train the students. Train the students in construction management, how to manage the job, that's more important. And the things I told you about what construction industry is expecting out of you. So if you, the alignment between institute and the construction sector is very, very important. That's where institute plays, should play an important role. They should, in addition to the all the technical subject, good, all, I'm telling you, all these are good subjects to teach. In addition to all this, please teach them about the construction management. Please teach them what skills the industries are looking for. You know, if you, it's not that, you know, the industry is wanting a structural engineer who wants only design. Yes, design is learned, is being taught in colleges, how to do a design of a beam and a column. But how to really, you know, manage the job on site. That to just not manage the small site, you know, sometimes you end up joining a large and complex projects. So these complex issues need to be managed. So it's what you need is a basic training in terms of, you know, how you plan the project, how you initiate the project, how you plan the project, how you monitor and control the project. Okay, so how you control the quality. Yeah, so these are the basic construction management tools that colleges should be teaching specifically, the skills that are in demand by construction sector.
Again, thank you, sir. Now, these things in the Indian construction industry, when we talk about,
yes,
there are many people who join together, there are colleagues and the superiors, mm-hmm, and other things. And we find a lot of, as I have 10 years of experience in the industry, I also faced a lot of challenges with respect to the crab mentality of the people.
Oh, all right.
Now, that's a thing wherein a fresher falls a prey to that, maximum, mm-hmm, of them.
Mm-hmm.
So, they don't even understand that this is happening to them.
Okay.
What way they can handle themselves in the industry from this colleague crab mentality, or even seniors, many times they do it.
Yes, that is, I think you have come up with very good questions, Mr. Patel. I must appreciate your questions. So what I'm saying is, when as a graduate engineer, the culture of crab mentality or leg pulling, you're going to face it in every field, whether it's you're in India or working abroad. So in this case, what I'm my advice, sincere advice to the young engineers and fresh graduates is that you stay professional. You go by book. You stay professional. You know, you always, your mannerism, your behavior, your respect to others should be controlled. I mean, you should be following all the ethical ethics in the construction industry. I mean, always people talk about you, they try to stop you from doing good things. So what you have to do is always, okay, stay calm, stay professional, not very friendly, but very professional at the work level. You can, of course, always, when you come out of the office, you can be friendly with them, but within the office, you need to be professional with each other. So what I'm saying is, in general, that you have to, as a young engineer, you must read all the documents in the construction. You must read project specification, you must read drawings, you must read the contract itself. What the contract, what is your scope, what is your role? So then use those knowledge about the job you're doing, about the observation you're doing on site, and raise it in the meetings. When the construction manager conducts a meeting with all the site engineers, always be very specific, very clear and loud in the meetings, and be very factual. Don't make general statements. Yeah, don't generalize the issues. Be very specific. What is wrong on site? How we can improve it? And what is, when you say something is wrong on site, you have to specify what's wrong with that concrete in the quality you have seen. So project specifications are there. So all these tools he should use and be a, make a professional behavior in the work, in the office, and in the meetings. That way you stand out from the crowd. All depends on your way of communication and behavior.
Okay, thank you, sir. And let me come down to the students' attitude, because yes, many of the HR people, right, when they take interviews in our institute, they come, or we send our students to those particular areas or wherever they call us. They may be Pune, Mumbai, based on the company. What attitude a student should have? Because discussion with the HR and other things, it has been found that there has to be a change in attitude of a student. But what exactly, what type of attitude a student, fresh engineer, should have so that he can get a good job, or even he can be very well, he can manage his job in the industry?
So the best attitude is, you always pay respect to some others. That's the best attitude you should have. And always see that the person who is sitting next to you, he is equal to you, he is same as you. So treat people with more respect. That kind of attitude you should have. That's the bottom line, and most important thing is, of course, the communication. Yeah? And as long as if you're doing a teamwork on a construction site, teamwork plays a very important role. It's not that only one person is there and you are doing everything. It's not like that. The construction is made up of so many packages, so many components. You are just handling one component of the project, for example. But rest of the team is doing the other jobs which are interfacing with you. So you have to be ready and face them. So how you do it? By doing a teamwork. So always adopt a teamwork approach, honest approach, and clear communicator. So these things will definitely take you a long way to survive in construction industry.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. I think students might have got an insight about the work culture environment in the industry. Let me take you further. Now, if you look at the today's situation and current situation in the industry, getting a job also is an issue, because of last 2 years, this pandemic and other things, we are facing a lot much of problem. But before that also, our students were placed at many good industries. We are trying to place them at maybe around one, because industry looks into the long-term interaction or long-term stay of that particular candidate with them, because they train them and everything is being done beyond the knowledge. But it has been found many of the time students leave maybe after 2 months or even 6 months, even if they get a good job, or they come back. They don't want to leave their maybe a comfort zone. That's what my assumption is. The students are afraid of losing their comfort zone. They don't want to go away from their home. So how can we motivate, or what can you suggest us that how can we motivate those students to work in the construction industry, especially when we talk about infra projects? Because they are good enough if it is in the city.
Correct. Right?
If they are into Pune, Mumbai, in the city, if the work is there, they are fine. They may continue the job. But if we are talking to them to go to the infrastructure projects, right, there is a reluctancy which comes from them. And then that's where actually the, instead of in the real estate, when I asked that question, my intention was that the real estate is a slow grower, but infrastructure is a fast grower.
Absolutely, I agree.
So if anybody, any engineer wants to progress, it always, I think as an engineer, that it should be an infra projects, wherein you can have a great growth. But even though that this is the situation, students are reluctant to join. So how can one motivate them, or what should we do?
See, working in infrastructure project will expose you to the various challenges. It offers more challenges and more knowledge when you compare it to the real estate. real estate, you might learn about building construction. Yeah, you might you know learn about lighting in the, or you might at the most learn about air conditioning, and of course little bit of fireproofing. But what the exposure of infrastructure projects are really big because they are huge in dimension. You learn about mass concreting. You learn about big foundations. You know, I mean, these kind of infrastructure projects will teach you a lot of other disciplines work also. Just not about, let us say, if you are a civil engineer for that matter, and you learn about concrete and steel, but infrastructure projects will expose you to all other disciplines, and which are, you know, really hardcore construction jobs. And this is what you should learn. You know, if you want to be a global player, if you just don't want to, you know, stick to a city, you want to work at national level, you want to work at international level, I always suggest that you go for infrastructure projects. Go and build a road, go and build a railway, go and build an international airport. And these kind of challenges, huge challenges, I mean, large and complex projects will teach you a lot of things. And also it will introduce to a lot of industrial experts. It will amazing, it will expose to the big multinational companies and the world global companies. So there's a lot of things to learn in infrastructure project. That's my take towards why you should work for infrastructure projects more than localized jobs within the cities or towns.
Thanks, sir. So I'll come back to the skill set basically.
Yes, sure.
Industry.
Correct.
So can you throw some light on the basic skills other than knowledge?
Correct.
Knowledge is what we try to provide, but other than knowledge related to technical knowledge,
correct,
what other skills industry is looking into when they're hiring a fresh engineer?
Yeah, this is another good question. Why? Because I talked about alignment between institutes and industrial construction sector. So as you come out of colleges, you were not aware of what kind of skills you should possess in order to get hired in construction. To tell you, construction sectors, construction companies, especially the organized construction sector, I'm not talking of small builders, the big organized construction sectors, they have very specific roles for every task on the project. You know, how you build a metro, how you build a airport, you have to build that, you have to break these kind of large projects into manageable components. I mean, the airport that we built in Qatar, we split it into 106 packages. Out of 106, I managed 6 packages. These 106 packages, they are millions of dollars against each packages. So what I'm saying is, so you have to you have to really concentrate and help towards achieving project goals. I mean, so the best skills when you want to work on construction sectors, there are some hot, very, very hot skills I would like to mention now. Is one is the most important, apart from, of course, the usual site engineer and construction engineers. They are, of course, in the bottom of the organization chart. As a graduate engineer, you may start as a site engineer, yeah, but that's just the bottom of the organization chart. So you may see most of the trades that construction sector is looking for is the planning. These are, I would say, a blue collar jobs. If you are a planning engineer, you can grow very well. If you are a cost engineer, you can grow very well. If you are a contract administrator, you can grow very well. How do you do the planning of the project? So there are some digital skills you need to learn. There are some special programs. You know, I mean, just planning, having a small critical path method, I can do using a critical path method, I can do a planning of a small house I'm living in. But I can't, you know, when a large project, if I have to manage a large project where there are more than 50,000, 100,000 activities, how can I draw a CPM chart? So you need to learn planning skills. The first and foremost, which is very highly demanding, is the planning. And next comes the cost control. Planning and cost, they're all fall under project controls. And of course, there is a lot of digital skills. You know, if you are working as a BIM modeler, or AutoCAD engineer. So these are very high in demand. Apart from, of course, the site engineer and construction, these are, of course, at the low level of organization chart. The highly best skills are planning, cost, contract administration, digital skills are prominent.
So thanks. I would like you to again just put current scenario of some light on the current scenario of Indian construction industry specifically.
Okay. So Indian construction industry is really big. Currently it is valued around $130 billion. That's a huge amount of money. $130 billion is $1 billion is about 7,500 crores of rupees. So you can just multiply and see how much is that. That's a huge money. Indian construction industry is the second largest employee offering organization, next to only agriculture. In India, we more than 35 million people depend on are currently employed in construction. So it's a very big opportunity, construction, you know. But as I said, construction, again, it's a huge sector. It is made up of large subsectors. The biggest one is infra and oil and gas projects, real estate projects, nuclear projects, industrial construction. So these are, and of course, the this ports, and there are many small sectors. More than we can list about 250 sectors, but all are falling within 5 or 6 sectors I just mentioned.
Can you put more like in the areas or the areas which a fresh engineer can seek for a job? Because at a glance, if you look at, they only have a line like this road projects, bridge, or a dam. The inside, if you look at, what are the various areas like quality control, maybe materials management, and this lineup, if you look at, what are the, as a fresh engineer, wherein he can seek a job?
Correct. Okay. So as a fresh engineer, actually, in one of the article I wrote, about what kind of positions are required on a large and complex project, I listed some 29 positions. You know, it's all the ways from starting from project director to site engineer level. So the basic structure of any project is broken into various departments. The main thing is the core team in the project. Core team always consists of project directors and project managers who are from various departments. The departments I mentioned is engineering and project controls, construction, quality control. Sometimes quality control and quality assurance go together. Another huge department is safety. So all these five subsectors of construction, they make up the entire construction team. And below this, for example, let us say talk about construction itself. Construction is the largest employer among this group. Construction is always the bigger team in this five groups I mentioned about. So in this, you have plenty of engineers, starting with field engineer. There is always a difference between field engineer and site engineer. Site engineer is the one who works on site with the drawings, with the specifications on site. He goes with the tape measurements and he starts building. He provides alignment. He tells the workers how to do the job. But the field engineer is the one who is sitting in the office. He's always looking into the drawings. He's always rectifying the drawings that are coming from engineering. So he is the one who assists the site engineer on site. He also controls the quality also. So this is under construction. You can be site engineer, you can be a field engineer, you can be construction manager. Yes. So So you can go start your ladder, career ladder, from site engineers all the way up to construction manager. Similarly, in project controls, you can start as a planning engineer. You can go up to becoming a project controls manager. Again, in project controls, you have cost control. Cost control, you can be a cost control where you can start it as an estimator. You have to do the takeoffs from the drawings. You have to estimate how much that particular item of concrete will cost you. How much of cubic meter concrete you have to pour in the project. So these are various trades the site engineer can look into. I mean, apart from that, he can be a safety engineer also. Why not? He can be a safety engineer. He can be a quality control engineer. He can be auditor, part of quality control department again. Or he can be a surveyor. You know, survey is part of all civil engineering. He can be a specialist in surveys. What I suggest for site engineers is always, you know, if you want to stick to one trade of construction, this is very important what I'm telling now. Maybe I think there are some 50 people here listening. My advice is always stick to the one trade of construction, in the sense, if you are building, let us say, residential type of construction or vertical growth, tall buildings, if you're building, try to stick to it, because if you develop skill 5 years, 10 years, if you spend on that, you'll become a industrial expert in that. And that's how, you know, the companies offer. You know, when you see the ads in the paper, what they say, I want to hire a construction manager who has experience about 5 years, 10 years. See how they mentioned about amount of experience. So what happens is, don't change the jobs once in 2 years. That reflects very bad on your CVs. So my suggestion is, try to be an industrial expert, and in particular field. If you want to be a structural engineer, if you want to be a design engineer, do only designs, you know. So keep accumulating years of experience so that you become a you know, a hot item, and people pick on you for the job or for experience. If you are building airports, you build only airports. If you are building metros, try to, you know, acquire more, do a similar projects. So that way you can build up your career.
Thank you, sir. The next, let to discuss about alignment of industry and institute. Yes. When we have visited lot many of industries to get aligned academically, I'm trying to tell the contribution of industry into academics, and as well as their help to enhance the skill sets of the people, students. But we failed a lot. Lot many times we have failed. Mm-hmm. By because industry is far ahead than what we are now. Mm-hmm. We are coping up with the maximum of the current needs of the industry. Mm-hmm. But again, they say that we don't have that much time. So aligning an institute with the industry for growth of the students, how can we take it up to the next level or further?
Yeah, so the alignment with the industrial construction, because I just want to give an example of what happens in Western countries. You see, if you see the Western style of education, it's more of a, you know, pragmatic kind of education, practical kind of education they provide. They associate more importance on practical side of the teaching. So what happens is, when you are teaching in India, of course, we are teaching more of theoretical subjects. With, of course, there is always practical step. Back in my 83, when I was graduating in 83, so I did some carpentry, I did some filing and all that. But it's not enough. You know, the practical education is very important. And that's what the institutes, present institutes, should actually encourage. Of course, always keep talking with industrial experts, construction companies, and maybe invite them to the colleges and try to arrange seminars or lectures, and they should be able to share their experience and the skill set they are looking for. And that's how we can, you know, build relation between yourself and the construction sector. Also request them for, you know, even if they don't want to recruit, it's fine, but they ask them to come down to your colleges and take campus interviews and see what kind of knowledge they have and watch what kind of, you know, ratings you get out of them. So it's very important that you keep communication live with construction companies and invite them to the colleges and to your campuses. That's and also ask them what kind of trades we should be teaching, what kind of trainings we should be providing in addition to what all the theoretical subjects we're teaching. I know the colleges are teaching building construction management, but I know the syllabus. Back in my days also, when I was studying building construction management, it was more of how to build a staircase, what should be dimension of brick, what should be dimension of tread and rises. That doesn't help. And I mean it's okay to learn all those things, but it doesn't tell you how to manage the construction, how to arrive at equipment outputs, how to arrive at manpower outputs. All those things the construction colleges are not teaching. That's what it's required. If on a construction site, if your manager tells you, okay, go, can you plan this activity? So what you do, to plan an activity, you have to first understand how much is the what is the quantum of work involved in that, and how much of productivity, how much of manpower is required to do that job, how much of equipment hour is required to do these jobs. So this kind of skills, if I know, I'll be a better construction engineers, and construction people, construction companies will be glad to take you on board.
So we are running out of time. I'll just take last question, which is very important, yes, with respect to as a first impression on job teams, that how should a CV, curriculum vitae of an engineer, and what should be the minimum contents we should go into the biodata or the curriculum vitae of an fresh engineer?
Yeah, so CVs, of course, you should be prepared by you. That's more important. Don't fall prey. You know, I know these days there are a lot of websites, there are a lot of agencies offering, when you browse Google, you will find there are a lot of people offering you jobs, and also they tell you about their services, and they will ask you to make payment, and they will create CV for you. So it is no good. What they do is they simply gold plate your CVs. So my basic request and advice to you is always prepare the CV for yourself. Keep it simple, one or two pages, not more than that. And these days, the latest technique is to add a video about yourself for a minute or two. And in the CV, apart from usual credentials like your name, your qualification, and about the project work, of course you have to mention about your project work, what you have done and how you achieved that project, and always pay attention to the data is very important. When you mention about project, how the project will help the society, so all those things you make it very clear, make factual statements. Don't gold plate your CV. Keep it simple as far as possible, and not more than two pages, and with the video, that is the latest technique, what I'm saying.
So take some tips on that. Last second question. I have
two questions last. No problem.
Can you throw some light on the upcoming areas in the construction industry as a whole?
Construction industry is really improving. Every day it is improving. With all these latest techniques that are coming up, new equipments that are coming up in construction. Just imagine, you know, back in our days, Mr. Patil, if you remember in Davao project, how you used to do the survey. We used to use, you know, theodolites, yeah.
So levels,
isn't it? Dump levels and all that. So now imagine there's a huge progress on that. So there is a lot of improvement. And every day there is a research going on. And construction sector is now becoming digitalized. I mean, the kind of softwares we are introducing, especially the BIM, Building Information Management, it is now changing the scenario of the construction manager. My sincere advice to all the youngsters who may be listening now is that try to, you know, develop your skill into this. Digitalization is very, very important. Learn BIM, learn AutoCAD, learn Revit, whatever the softwares, you know. I mean, I know it's going to be costly to learn most of the things, but that's what's going to, at the end of the day, it's going to help you to, you know, develop your skill. And that's what the construction is demanding. And construction, as I said, even artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, all things are going to come in place. And the thing is, twin digitalization is also coming up. What do you mean by twin digitalization? It means I can create a twin of, let us say, a city of Mumbai. I can create digital twin of the Mumbai city itself. So it helps in, you know, for BMC, for example, Bombay Municipal Corporation, it helps them to, you know, plan the projects, you know, with the twin digital, they can plan every street, they can plan the new construction, they can plan the utilities. So there's a lot of good things happening in construction. Stay tuned, it's very important. I mean, to keep abreast with the latest technology is very, very important. Even what I'm saying is, I know because of the compelling reasons, you may just want to join after graduation. No, I have to work because you have to earn your bread and butter, isn't it? So yeah. At the same time, when you are earning in remote areas, like Mr. Patil is keep asking about remote areas, it's when you work in remote areas, you're away from family, use that time to develop skills, do remote classes. A lot of colleges offering online courses. Try to learn those things and improve yourself. Learning never stops. Keep learning as long as you know it's possible.
Yeah, that's great.
One more question, the last question.
Yes, please.
I'd like to take this question, please.
Yes, and you can also take one question from chat box also.
Yeah, I'm going to take them. I don't worry about that. The last question from my side is how one can, in an Indian construction industry, whatever the what we are seeing right now, very much important is to manage the work-life balance.
Oh.
So how can you... what can you suggest us? How can we do that?
Yeah, it is actually two-way. I mean, employers and employees also, both should be putting their efforts towards this. It's very important we bring this culture in India. And I was asking Mr. Kale, has it improved anything in India? So he thinks it is not so. So even I think it has remained the same. Working culture in India has not improved. When I was working back in up to 1996, I was in India. But so there are things to improve. I mean, as I was telling you, it is both employees. As an employee, you can do you should always treat life and work with the same respect. In India, we have a culture, we have a habit of treating work as important. You know, you just shout at your family members, no, I'm going to work, don't interfere. Yeah, I mean, I know your mother, your wife is trying to tell you, okay, go eat this, eat that, but don't go without eating, but you don't listen to them because your work is important. You just rush out. That's what I've seen. So always pay respect to life equally as you respect the work. That's from your side. I mean, and also team up, not only as an individual, also with association within the in the office. Have a team of engineers who are maybe having same interest. Discuss your requirements. Discuss this issue with the human resources of the companies, and try to raise importance of what is why it is important to be part of the family. Why it is important he pays attention, equally important attention to the family. And as an employee, of course, you should develop that as a company. You should always, you know, state in your ethics, values, visions, values, and covenants that all policies are not just written in black and white, but they should be implemented. You know, a company should enforce very restricted work hours. Let us say if it is 8 hours or 10 hours of work written in appointment letter, ensure that they work within 10 hours. See that they are out of office. You know, when you see the Western way of working, that's how they work. I mean, they at the end of the work, after 6 o'clock, there is hardly anyone in the office. But come to India, you will see still people hanging around in the office because boss is there inside. You don't want to go because boss is still inside. So that's, we need really cultural change, big cultural change for such things to happen in India. As I said, it's two way. Employers and both employees and employers should really work towards this. And of course, there are techniques like adopt what multinational companies are doing. Most important is the discipline. There is always restriction on working hours. Anybody is made to work additional hour, they should be compensated in terms of money. Or in terms of compensatory off later on, because they should spend time with the family and they should get value for the work they're doing.
Thank you, sir. To all the audience and the people in the meeting, I'd like to request you stay tuned. We'll be just taking you ahead maybe around 5 more minutes, and I'll take the questions which are there in the chat box. So it's a good question, basically, but I'd like to tell Yogesh that the scenario has already changed a lot, but I'll ask that question to the guest of honor. So his question is, construction industry in India is male-dominated, right? There are very few women in the technical, architectural, structural engineering or management roles.
Mm-hmm.
What specific advice you will give us mm-hmm. or give to the women engineers, right? To succeed in this particular or in construction industry?
Yes, it's a very good question. Actually, the things are changing, as you rightly said. Even in the remote areas, we are finding women are becoming part of this construction. And it's great to see them because they bring a lot of value and quality culture to the team itself. And brings a lot of mannerism in the construction. my only precaution with lady folks and women folk is that always treat the professional working as a professional, keep the relations at the professional level in the offices. That's very important. And in Western countries, though people are related, or he may be a good friend, or she may be a good friend with somebody else, or she may be a husband of someone in the office, but they never discuss personal things in the office. And they always only work-related things are discussed. And behavior is absolutely professional. That's what you should focus on as a
part of the employer, part of the office.
Correct.
But what specifically the our girl students or the women students should mm-hmm. Take to go ahead in the industry and make some, other than This was a culture in the office, suppose.
Correct.
At the BTEC, till they are studying, what they should try to do, or specific, what are the specific roles they should focus on, that this is a good role for an woman engineer to be in the office. Nowadays, we have changed a lot. Like, we are associated with few companies wherein there are many ladies working right from the site to the office.
Yes, the only restriction for women folks is, you know, when it comes to really hardcore construction, let's say you are imagining that you have to climb a certain ladder or you have to climb a certain floor. Physical climbing and all that, it's a bit difficult for a woman to do. So I would suggest for women is, you know, your best positions to work in construction sector is in planning or a contract administrator or even a field engineer or you know, or a procurement engineer. So, but you don't want to be, you know, really unless if you can do a light type of construction is fine, but you know, heavy industrial construction demands, and they very specifically mention, you know, when they are hiring, and job profile description very clear that you are required to climb, you are required to, you know, tie a safety belt and go up. So this kind of tasks are very difficult for ladies. So, but there are a lot of skills they can work on. Like, they can be a very good draftsman. She can be a very good designer. She can be very good contract administrator. She can be a good planner. So I have seen many of them actually performing the work these days.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. And his next question was about, which is a partial question basically. I'll request Yogesh, if you are there, can you just complete the sentence? Because what are some of the things civil engineering students who wish to start the? I didn't got the. Yogesh, are you there? Yeah, please, sir. Now you're mute.
You're unmute.
Unmute yourself.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
First of all, thank you so much for, you know, great insights. Some of the things which you mentioned, Mr. Narali sir, like, you know, how to prepare CV and your thoughts on technology like machine learning and all. I think in my mind that is really important. And some of the meetings we had with the departments, we have been also talking with college to introduce these subjects for all branches, not just the computer engineering students. So that's really good insight. So coming to my question, and most of our discussion so far we had in this meeting, we spoke about how students should prepare for jobs. However, my question was, what would be your advice to how students should prepare themselves if they want to start their own business in this industry rather than looking for a job?
Yeah, this is one of the option, you know. Because I know the jobs are very, very rare these days. As in one of the article I had written, because it's not the fault of, and it's partially fault of our own students by not really being, mentally and aptitudinally very highly skilled. You know, this is of course the survey conducted by one of the analytical firm. Is that in India, more than 15 lakh engineers are passing out every year, and only 25% are really employable. This was a report produced by one of the analytical firm. I forgot the name of the firm now. So what happens? Why we are lacking the basic skill for employability? Back in Middle East also, I have seen the same thing. Most of the staff, that engineer staff that is coming from Asian countries, are given such jobs which are not of managerial capacities. They're mostly a supervision level capacities. So that's because they are not really confident of the skill sets you have learned in your colleges. The colleges that institutes are not very well recognized outside. So coming to the your question is about why what kind of why he cannot start the work on his he can start his own business. He can do that. That's one of the option. Of course, he need to be having, you know, to start any business, he need to have a license to do that, isn't it? And also he need to have proper budget. And I've seen many success stories. Of course, as you rightly pointed out, they can start, they can simply hire 10 or 15 skilled labor and start as a petty contractors. They can start as a petty contractor and he can be very successful. It's all about, you know, how you apply yourself, you know, how you apply your own skills and the knowledge you have acquired over the years. But it definitely is, to start a business is not easy, yeah? And very few people success, but this success in a great way that I have seen it. But for my suggestion would be always start small, be a small contractor, petty contractor, start from scratch, and you will definitely succeed one day.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, please.
Yeah, Mirza sir, last 2 minutes we'll take, don't worry. Sir, one more thing. Our students, which are the countries in other than India, which are suitable for Indian students or Indian civil engineer students to apply for the jobs?
Yes, yes.
As the sir has came up.
Correct. It's apart from India and Middle East is the hottest area where civil engineers kind find a job. Middle East is there's a lot of construction happening in Middle East, and more than currently about if I'm not mistaken, about 35 lakh people are working in Middle East. And 20% of this 35 lakh is about engineers, and most of them are, of course, skilled and unskilled laborers working in Middle East. So 20% of them make engineers, and you see, it requires a lot of because Western countries in Middle East, working in Middle East is what happens. The formula in Middle East is that, you know, the owner is always the local sheikh, yeah. He always want to hire the Western staff as a manager, sitting in the office, directing people. But actually, the people who are working on site are none but Indians. And Indians, why I say Indians? Because in general, I should say Asians, but majority of them are still Indians working in Middle East. And in Middle East is the one of the largest area where people can, you know, and there are a lot of opportunities every day. They appear in paper and newspapers, and then on job portals also. Apart from Middle East, of course, if we can invest some money, I prefer Canada to be the second best, because it's offering a lot of opportunities, plenty of opportunities. There's no limit, and Australia is another country, and of course, if you can spend more money, nothing like going to US or Europe.
Thank you very much. I've done my part, and Abbas Sahib or
thank you, sir.
Mirza, sir, I'll hand over. Thanks a lot for giving me a chance to interact with such a great human personality.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Only one suggestion for, as Dilip sir is also there, and you as well as Kumbhar sir is also there. Before I hand over to Kumbhar sir, one of the most important thing which I, as a passionate construction professional, feel, and Dilip sir will agree with me, that we do not inculcate culture of project planning and health and safety environment aspects. I mean, believe me, if your product from college, the final student, has these two virtues, great respect for HSC aspects, health, safety, environment aspects, and great respect for project planning, she will be employed in any top rated construction company, real estate company, or multinational company.
That's right.
We will take that as a separate agenda with Mr. Dilip Nalode. Thank you, both of you, for being here. and helping us. I hand over this session to conclude to HOD of our institute, Professor Kumbhar. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
So at the outset, I must thank Honorable Engineer Dilip Naloda Sahib for interacting with us through this interview. So respected Honorable Director Madam of RIT, the RAHA team, including Abba Sahib Kale sir, and Yogesh sir, Mirza sir, all the colleagues of RIT and the staff members and the students. And I must also thank Professor D.S. Patel for drafting very good questions for this interview, which helped us to have the sharing of the experience of Engineer Dilip sir. And before I go for concluding from my side, I would like to just take to my department information. Briefly, I will just would like to tell about my department. The department started, established in 1983 along with the institute itself. Right now, we are having one UG civil engineering program, and we are also running two PG programs, one in engineering and another is construction management. Total 20 faculties are there. Most of us are either MTech and PhDs. We have 8 staff members, and more than 300 students are taking education in the department. There are some students from foreign countries also. We have several MOUs. We have got well-established laboratories, more than 12 laboratories, and we have also recognized PhD Research Center, which has been recognized by Sivaji University Kolhapur. We provide consultancy and testing services to various private and government organizations. And we are organizing various webinars, conferences, etc. for the benefit of the students and all the stakeholders. So coming to this particular, say, interview or interaction session, I must thank once again to Abba Sahib Kale and the entire RAHA to organize such a interview session, which would help definitely to our students. In fact, we, as far as our training and placement coordinator is concerned, we both and the entire our team of Department of Civil Engineering, we are trying for last 2-3 years, especially in improving these placements of our students. And I must say that this is one of the opportunities that we got through the sharing of the experience of Dilip sir, because we were looking for this activity, and I can say this is one of the activities that would help us in helping our students to get the jobs in the industry. As rightly stated by Honorable Dilip sir, that the students or the graduates must look at the cost, time, safety, quality control, quality assurance, entire as far as the project management is concerned, he must be there, that the student must take into account all these things, and most importantly, the graduates at the site must respect each and everything. There should be a work-life balance, work culture has to be there. Definitely, we must, we will be following the advice that has been given by our guest, and he has also shared with us that the graduates must get some orientation whenever he wants to take a job at the site, and he must have the knowledge of softwares. And one more thing that he has that the graduates must prepare 1-minute video as far as the introduction part is concerned. And I'm very happy to tell you, sir, that we have prepared the cards of our students, the graduates who are going to be graduated from in the last year. So we have prepared everyone's card, where whatever the skills, what likings are there with the students, maybe have written along with the photographs and all the things. And this would be added information for us. We can include in our curriculum. I'm sorry, the vitae. This would be very informative for us, and definitely we will work on this. And one more point you stated, and that would be a takeaway for all of us, that you stated that our graduate should work in a particular area, in a specific area, whenever he or she wants to join the in the industry. So that would be very important for me and the entire our faculty as well as students. So we should work in a specific field so that one can achieve the expertise, and then it would be better for the development of even our nation. So with this few concluding remarks, I would also say thankful to for sharing this particular, say, one more point from your side, that you need to, one need to stay professional at the work place or at the work level. So that is also one of the, so for sharing your experience, I must thank, and I also thank the entire team and all the faculty members, staff members, and all the people, those who are present right now in this particular session, for this kind of a good experience to our entire team. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir. You, Abbas, sir. Thank you, sir. Once again, thank Rudy, sir, Professor Patil,
thank you
for helping us to initiate this and execute this event. Stay safe and good night. I declare
good night. Good night. Thank you very much.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night. Thank you all for joining. Good night.